Good morning, church family. Good morning, friends. Glad that you're again with us this morning for worship. And also for a time for us to delve in and look at scripture together, learn and grow together. Let's briefly pray before we begin. Father, good morning. We realize, Lord, that for some of us right now, this pause for prayer may be the first time we've come before you all week. Forgive us for that. We've allowed the busyness, the distractions. We've fallen into things in life that just have no lasting value for us. So, Lord, we ask this morning that your Spirit would remind us, that it would pull us, draw us to you, to attend to you, not just for this hour on Sunday morning, but for every day. when we wake up, we would realize, wow, you're here with us. When we're busy going through the motions throughout the day, Lord, that you'd help us to take a moment and recognize that you are guiding our steps each day. Tonight, when we get into bed, help us to recognize, wow, Lord, you've kept us safe all day. And whatever happens in between those hours, we know that you're with us. You're an awesome God, and we love you. Father, briefly, just ask for your care, for your protection. So many people now are struggling with health issues. Just pray for our caregivers, the doctors and nurses, the aides. Help them, Lord. Help them to just keep fighting in the battle. Give them energy. Lord, we know they're fatigued. Give them encouragement. And where we, as your children, can see a need, help us to step in and give them that encouragement in your name. Father, thank you. Thank you for your lesson that you have for us this morning. I ask that you would now help me to teach that lesson clearly. And I pray that your Spirit would help all of us to understand. But also I'd ask that your Spirit would help us to break down any resistance that we may have this morning. Pierce our souls. Clear our minds. Thank you, Lord. Amen. I have to admit, certain weeks I look forward to preaching certain lessons, and then there are other weeks where I don't look forward to it so much. And this week is the latter. Not really looking forward to it so much because so many of us struggle in this area. So again, I ask that you continue to be in prayer throughout this lesson this morning as we study together. Now, I began preparing this lesson a few weeks ago, and I read a true story about a woman named Bertha Adams. She died a few years ago. And the reason that she died was because of malnutrition. She wasn't eating enough and passed away. When she died, she only weighed about 50 pounds. Apparently, she had reached out to her neighbors and asked for food from time to time. But the neighbors had noticed that she hadn't reached out to them for a while, and so they were concerned for her, called the police, and found that she had passed away. When the police went into her house, it was a mess, a huge mess. In the closets, the clothes were threadbare. I mean, they were like rags. She hadn't bought any clothes, any furniture. It didn't look like she had anything that had been purchased within the last 20, 30 years. So it was just assumed that she was very poor. But in the house, they found two keys for a safe deposit box. So they went to the bank, opened it up, pulled out the safe deposit box, and found that she had 700 stock certificates there that were worth loads of money. I also found $800,000 in cash in those safe deposit box. So Bertha had died a millionaire. But ironically, she died of starvation. Now, obviously, her death was tragic. But I believe the worst thing about that story is that she was so obsessed with wealth, with materialism. Now, clearly, she wasn't obsessed with spending her wealth, but instead with saving it obsessively. So her wealth had become an idol for her. And her death teaches us that wealth can't provide us with what we need the most. Maybe we know, maybe we've heard growing up, and I know I've have certainly taught about it before from time to time. We've talked about materialism in previous sermons. But the culture's message, what we see out there, what we learn from films and the news, and what we see our neighbors participating in, what we see in commercials, all teaches us that our best life comes with constant improvement, constant expansion of your wealth, constantly replacing and upgrading things. That's the message that we see is prevalent out there. Now, hopefully, as Christians, we've learned that that's a lie. But again, what we see out there, it's attractive. It easily sucks us in. I mean, ask your children. Ask your kids, for example, for Christmas. What did they get? The most recent iPhone. And your kids look at that, right? And they say, well, I want one too. Why can't I have one? Maybe your brother-in-law visits for the holidays and he's got a new car. You say, have you seen his new car? Man, I wonder how much that costs. I wouldn't mind having one myself. Your friend got a new home, a larger home, a newer home. And now you're thinking, man, my house is feeling pretty small, pretty old. Maybe we should move too. That pull, that draw is pretty strong, can be pretty strong. Many of us try to balance what the Bible teaches about wealth, and then balance that with what we see out there in culture. We say, well, I know what the Bible says. I know what I'm seeing there. But honestly, most people really can't find a balance. And the consequences for that can be serious. The consequence can be severe because what Jesus teaches here, what we're reading this morning, is not complicated. Honestly, it's not complicated at all, but it's hard. It is tough. But if we really want to honor the Lord, to obey his commands first, we have to admit something. We have to admit that we actually do struggle with materialism, whatever that may look like. We do struggle with our stuff. Your income, your education, your background, it really doesn't matter. If you grew up here in the United States, this passage that we're reading today will challenge you. And you need to ask the Father for humility and ask the Spirit for help and for wisdom. Let's look at Scripture. Jesus is continuing to teach from his Sermon on the Mount. And he said, don't store up your treasures here on earth, where moths eat them, and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Instead, store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. Now, context is always important. So we need to understand why Jesus taught this here and for whom he was speaking and what was happening at the time. So back then, there were three ways that people typically grew wealth back in those days. First was clothing. The second was food. And then lastly, it was through precious metals. So gold and silver. If you had a lot of those things, that's how you accumulated wealth back in those days. They didn't have, you know, interest-bearing bank accounts. So things that they collected was what accumulated their value. Now, clothing back then had a lot of value. Do you remember this story about Achan in Joshua chapter 7? Remember, Israel had been battling and finally overcame their enemies. The Lord commanded them, okay, now that you have overcome your enemies, leave all of their things, gold and silver, all of the things that they have, leave them alone. But there was a man named Achan, and he went ahead and took some clothing for himself and hid it in his tent. I mean, the temptation was strong because clothing, I mean, it was beautiful, but it was also worth a lot back then. And so Jesus' reminder there is, it doesn't matter how well something is stitched, eventually all clothes will be destroyed, right? The stitching will wear out, moths will eat it and destroy it. Food, specifically grain back then, you can have a whole pile of grain that you keep, but eventually rats, worms, wild animals will find it and will destroy it. And your gold and your silver, you can try and hide it. You can bury it. Remember, they didn't have banks back then, so people would just hide or bury their valuable things. But Jesus is saying, you know, thieves will find it. They'll break in and steal it. So Jesus' point here is not that all wealth is bad. No, money and property, if we get rid of it, completely get rid of it, that doesn't make us more holy. And God doesn't forbid wealth. That's important to understand. Never forbids wealth. Now, maybe Jesus means that it's not necessary to save for the future. You know, some people say, well, I don't need to save anything at all because I can just trust in God and everything will be fine. I don't have to plan for retirement because Jesus will take care of me. That's not what he means either. It can't be, because in Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 to 8, he encourages saving and planning for the future. So what does Jesus mean here? What is he focusing on? He's talking about the heart. Of course, it always begins with the heart. Selfish motives, excessive greed, allowing our stuff, our things to become our priority, allowing our stuff to become our goals. That's when it's the problem. In Luke chapter 12 helps us to understand what he's saying here. He says, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own. Now you may read verse 15 or what we've talked about so far and think, oh, well, I'm not wealthy, so it doesn't apply. I don't really own a lot. I have no private property, just, you know, my house or my apartment. That's it. So I don't think Jesus is talking about me here. Now I know there are some people out there like that, but not me. But the caution here is for everyone, for you, for me, for all of us, whether you are financially wealthy or not. Because again, verse 19 says treasures. So what does that word mean? Yes, of course it can mean money, it can mean financial wealth, it can mean property. But the Greek word there actually means whatever your focus is, whatever you are motivated by, whatever you hope for and wish for, and whatever you dwell on, that becomes your God, replacing the God instead of the God. So maybe money is not important to you, but maybe your home is. Maybe you spend a lot of time and money and energy constantly improving your home, replacing and upgrading things. And maybe the reason is because you're never satisfied. Doesn't matter what you've done, what you've remodeled, what you've changed, you're never content with it. You know, sometimes family itself can become our idols. Family first, or we put our children first. We give very little time for church family or for neighbors who need me, who have needs, because our life goals become just keeping the family happy, keeping the family entertained. It's like every day is their birthday. We have to do so much for our family. We don't have time for anyone else. So again, you may not focus on wealth, but you still have something that you treasure. Maybe it's your position at work. Maybe that's your treasure. Maybe that means everything to you. Maybe certain memories are your treasure. If there's something in this world that means everything to you, that's what he's talking about here. And he's saying, if you are trying to hold on to whatever it is that you treasure, you can't be my disciple. And why? Jesus made it clear. Because that treasure, whatever it is, whatever it looks like, that treasure will not last. It cannot last. Meaning when you die, you can't package it up and bring it with you. Jesus' challenge here, the real issue, is that he wants you to have Christ's perspective about life and death. That's the real issue here. And we've discussed materialism. We're talking about stuff and things, but really, the issue here is life and death. Your life here on earth is short. It's temporary. It's limited. The average lifespan here in the U.S. is only 78 and a half years. 78 and a half years. And I know for young people who are watching this, they think 78 and a half years feels like an eternity. But it's not. When you get older, every year it feels like time is starting to run out. And indeed, it is. Time is running out every day. We are one step closer to our time running out here on earth. But our eternal life will never run out. After you die, you will live for eternity. So the question, of course, then is, will you live with God the Father in heaven, or will you live in hell? And I pray and I hope that you already know the answer. I hope that you're confident with your answer. Now, for Christians, while we're here, yes, we live here in the world. We can enjoy our time here. But eternal life is our focus. How we live right now, are we preparing ourselves for heaven? Our actions, our relationships, what we do every day, are we preparing for heaven? Let's look at verse 20 again. Jesus said, instead, store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. Jesus is saying, while we're here, focus, invest your time, your talent, your resources for Him. It's all about Him, for His people. Because that will last forever. So, for example, when you worship God, when we gather here, we study His Word, or you join your Bible study group during the week, when you spend time in the morning reading your Bible, thinking about writing notes, whatever it is that you do for your personal study time, that investment is eternal. It will have an impact for your eternity. You're growing your relationship with Him. When you love Him and you love people, meaning you give your time and you share the gospel, that investment will have an eternal impact. I mean, when you get to heaven, how many people will be there? Because you took the time to share the gospel. Because you took the time to love them, to show them His grace. You've served and supported His church financially. You help missionaries do their work. When you have helped people who are poor, truly poor within your community, you've met their need. When you've helped a neighbor for Jesus, that's eternal. Our lives are committed to loving Him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and loving our neighbor. There is no greater purpose here. There is no greater mission here. Now you notice verse 21, Jesus cautions. He cautions us to be careful. Examine your heart. Because honestly, we are really good at fooling ourselves. We say, you know, I'm not that bad. I balance life pretty well. But we can't fool the Lord. Let's look at verse 21. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. Whatever it is that you treasure is where your heart is. Now remember, when you see that word heart, In biblical meaning, it's talking about a person's emotions, desires, all of that. It's not just the emotion, it's everything. Jesus wants us to look in the mirror spiritually, assess our souls. Where is your heart? What are your temporary, are they on, is it on temporary earthly priorities or lasting eternal ones? Few questions I want us to think about this morning. I'm going to throw out each question separately. I'm hoping that you'll look at it, think about it before we move on to the next. Here's the first. When you have nothing else going on, just sitting with downtime, relaxing, nothing else going on, what do you think about? What do you daydream about? That's where your heart is. Second question. What do you worry about? What do you worry about the most? Is it your home? Your clothing? Your appearance? Not having enough money? Where is your heart there? And the third question. What are you most afraid of losing? Let's make it fair. Let's say family aside. What are you most afraid of losing? Fourth question. How do you typically measure or judge other people? What is it based on? Is it based on their education, their job, their political views, their faith, their athletic abilities, their successes? What is it? Or do you look at them based on their passions, their compassion, their faith, their humility? Again, that's where your heart is. And the last question. What's the one thing that you can't be happy, can't be satisfied, can't be at peace without? What's the one thing? If you didn't have that one thing, it would be impossible to be content. I strongly encourage you to take some time to think through those questions. Your heart, your emotions, your desires, your thoughts, your wants, where are they? Have you thought about life with God forever? This is a little off topic, and I won't get too far down this road, but another topic here is, do we really understand heaven? Can we really envision how His holiness impact everything? I mean, imagine a perfect relationship. Can you envision a perfect relationship in perfect harmony? Envision nature being perfect. No impact from environmental changes, from pollution, everything in perfection. Can you imagine? Perfect health.
eternal life with the Lord? Are you looking forward to it? Imagine your best day here on earth still can't even closely compare to a day in heaven. Bottom line, I think Jesus' biggest point here is if you really belong to him, if you are truly a follower of Jesus Christ, this world, I mean, it's nice. We can enjoy it. But this is not our home. It's not our home. We are not permanent citizens here. We're temporary residents. For example, you move to another country for a few years, let's say for work. You have your visa. You get in, you can work in the country, you can live there, you can enjoy life there. But you can't live there permanently. One day, you have to go back home. That's us here, so to speak. We understand where we truly belong. Our permanent home. And then life makes sense. Then we understand all that God has given us, intelligence, education, our homes, our jobs, our health, all of that. We don't have to hold on to it. I mean, yeah, we have to take care of it, but to use it for his purpose. We are just stewards. We are just stewards of what he's given us. Because our use for it is only temporary while we're here. Again, we can enjoy life here fully. But go back to the beginning of the story, Bertha. Remember what she teaches us. Our stuff, our wealth, our things, our earthly relationships will never satisfy our true needs. I mean, those things are wonderful. But our true, permanent, eternal needs will never be met by them. I wonder how many of us now are starving. Starving, spiritually speaking. We're starving because we're wasting time. We're wasting our energy, searching and pursuing desires, worshiping, so to speak, the wrong things. What is your treasure? Where is your heart? Ask Jesus. Ask him to help you. Invest your life for eternity. Amen.
This world reveres and wars to own. All I once thought gain, I have counted loss, spent and worthless now compared to this. Knowing you, Jesus. No. My righteousness, and I love.